Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Rebecca O'Brien. I'm a psychology and sociology undergraduate here in the University of Limerick. I'm here today to talk you through the ABCs of OCD. Obsessive compulsive disorder is an anxiety disorder that affects as many as 12 in every 1,000 people from young children to adults, regardless of gender. It can be so debilitating and disabling that the World Health Organization has ranked it in the top 10 of the most disabling illnesses of any kind in terms of lost earnings and diminished quality of life. In the United States alone, approximately 1 in 40 adults and 1 in 100 children have OCD. OCD is characterized by persistent and uncontrollable thoughts or urges and by the need to repeat certain acts again and again. Individuals with OCD usually try to actively dismiss or neutralize an obsession by performing a compulsion, but this is a short-term fix that ends up feeding the OCD cycle. Both obsessions and compulsions interfere considerably with daily functioning and quality of life. Obsessions are unwanted and unacceptable thoughts, images or impulses that passively appear in your mind. Compulsions are the physical or mental actions and reactions that actively follow from obsessions and which are motivated by the obsessions. More women have compulsive washing, which is the most common clinically presented manifestation, and more men have sexual obsessions, magical numbers or obsessional slowness. Other manifestations of OCD occur with checking and verifying things, amongst others. The DSM is the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, and its criteria for OCD is as follows. A. The presence of obsessions, compulsions or both. B. That these are time consuming and take more than 1 hour a day. C. The disturbance is not better explained by the symptoms of another mental disorder. And D. The disturbance is not due to the physiological effects of the substance. Anyone in the room who finds themselves identifying family, friends or even yourselves in these slides, remember that a disorder such as OCD is defined by the extreme, inflexible and maladaptive ways in which these traits are expressed. There is no single proven cause of OCD. Research suggests that a genetic predisposition to OCD is likely, and potential developmental factors may include emotional, physical and sexual abuse. OCD can present in adults as a consequence of certain neurological conditions such as a brain tumour or Huntington's chorea. Many theories have been proposed for OCD, however, cognitive behavioural models of OCD have generated much empirical support and have led to the development of effective treatments. The theory asserts that the obsessions experienced by people who suffer from OCD are not qualitatively different from those who don't. The difference lies in the meaning attached to the intrusions. When one considers intrusive thoughts as an indication that harm may come to themselves or others and they are responsible for such harm, then it's hypothesized that they will experience the characteristics of OCD. It is not fully understood why some people make responsibility appraisals and why others do not. However, Salkowski proposes that a predisposition towards making responsibility appraisals results from a dysfunctional belief that are learnt in childhood or as a result of unusual or traumatic events. The theory suggests that the misinterpretation of the significance of intrusions has a number of important effects. These include negative affect, attention and reasoning biases, which is focusing attention onto the intrusions and onto triggers in the environment that may increase their occurrence. Increased accessibility to and preoccupation with the intrusive thoughts and behavioural responses, including neutralising reactions, in which the person seeks to reduce or escape responsibility. Forms of treatment include CBT, medication and neurosurgical treatment. Cognitive behavioural therapy is a treatment that is recommended by nationally recognised institutes such as the Mayo Clinic and the Harvard Medical School. It should be offered as a first-line therapy for those with mild to moderate OCD and is based on a programme of structured self-help. The first aspect of ERP exposure involves prolonged exposure, whereby they confront anxiety-provoking situations, and this is graded on a scale of 0 to 100. For someone with a fear of contamination, a score of 30 might be for touching the rim of an unwashed coffee cup, and a score of 100 might be for using a public toilet. The second aspect of ERP, response prevention, involves the prevention of compulsive responses or rituals that aim to neutralize the distress or threat. 75% of those treated with ERP improve significantly and stay so for up to 5 years after treatment is discontinued. Although many patients with OCD respond well to medication and psychotherapy, 40 to 60% continue to experience symptoms despite treatment. The American Association of Neurological Surgeons, as of September 2014, endorses the use of deep brain stimulation in severe OCD patients who fail to respond to other avenues of treatment. Deep brain stimulation is the placement of electrodes in specific areas of the brain, followed by electrical stimulation of these areas. Only 20% of OCD patients who don't respond to treatment experience remission, so DBS allows these people with another yet severely invasive avenue of treatment. That is the other implication of this new research, is the severity of side effects, which include infection, hemorrhage, seizure, and psychological complications. Thanks very much for listening.
created using Powtoon.